start. I'm Swaminathan Fernando. I was the president 2013-2014, right? So these are, there's a notice there. Please read the notice and come. Right? Not a punishment, it's a welcome sign. Please, be my guest. So we need to fill up the, please read the notice and come, right? Lakshan, you again and cut it. Read the notice and come. Right. Okay. You have already started a couple of lectures. Okay. You want to become corporate members of the Institute of Indian Studies. And I know you see a lot of lecture people. I know you have interest if you're getting your class from some side, and if the engineering house is coming in, you right? That are your group that. Well, meet that notice and come, please. I mean, wisdom. Right? If engineers cannot understand discipline, why do you want to be cutting to begin with? Right? The first is ranking. I'm not talking about the little bit of late, because the money. People have to finish their work at half, so again, you have 50 minutes break. Right? So it's a way of life. And because, you know, there was a guy who had a management lecture for us some time ago, and he said, where are all the CEOs and appointed lectures, maybe I'm the word, people can't rush and take up tables in front of them. It's only in Sri Lanka that they went up with the last. So he has gone to Maldives and conducted a and so he has been watching, and all the people are coming in front, and some people are going to be there. So, he has asked the organizer, what are those who are not those who are from Sri Lanka? All those who want to wear the vaccine are Sri Lanka. Right? If you go to any event in India, you go 2 minutes, 3 minutes late, you can't get a seat in the front seat. Go on. Once I went to our invitation to the Stopping Engineers Gangway sessions in Madras, the president was coming, he was there on time, right? Even when we didn't have to die, our even our invited seats, so the invite is occupied by the Indian. So these are the organs who were there, they will have to taste all the people out and give the hospital in front. Right? So that is how the Indians work, these are how the Sri Lankans work, and we blame Indians for shoddy work. Anyway, let's see. Right. I do a little bit of exercise, but I'll skip because before I start anything, I want to share with you some of my favorite quotes that, and videos and quotes that, and anecdotes. Right. So I thought, you know, before giving an introduction to the B paper, I must also tell you what an engineer is, who an engineer is, what about. Right. I know that you all have been in the field for at least 5, 6, 7, 10 years even. Right. But still, sometimes I wonder, do the people know what engineering is? Do the people know who the engineers are? Do they know what we are supposed to do? And I do this lecture in all of the countryside. And one thing I asked after I talked about the ISL, I put some practice. What is the equivalent of ISL in the medical field? Intangible competency? What is the equivalent of ISL in the medical field? Tell me. Fantastic. But where am I go? Include the team. Right? In the province, they can be GMO. GMO is a trade union. ISL is not a trade union. Please keep that in mind. We are a learned society and we are a highly professional organization that we want to be. Right? So I'm just giving some few quotes. Here's a quote from a very good friend of mine called Arup Roy Chowdhury. He has been one of the youngest CEOs ever to be appointed in an Indian big conglomerate, right? Of what he said about 300,000 people when he was about 30 years old, or 33 years old to be exact. So I don't think what he said there is anything wrong, right?
So he has put out a book that called Management by Idiots, and he presented that to me when I went there. And he happened to be the CEO of the National Thermal Power Corporation when I was in the electricity board. What did he say? If you don't blow your own trumpet, others will make it a spittoon. You know spittoon? Right? Now that doesn't mean to say that you every year you go and say, my God, I'm going to be bloody, you can't listen to me.
That's not what I'm talking. Let your acts and actions speak about yourself.
Right? That's what I mean by blowing your own trumpet. Right? When I say blowing your trumpet, now don't go and start talking to everybody and say, haha, today you all better know that I am the engineer in this place. Okay? I am the engineer in this place. Don't do that. That's what I'm talking about. But you know, some of us truly behave like that, you know. Sometimes they think, my dear friend,
English.
Right? Now see, we can't even read a simple message and obey. And we can't go and talk about the country and say this world is all useless, corrupt, they don't know how to run this place. We engineers don't know how to behave ourselves.
Let's start it from us. Let's behave as responsible engineers.
Okay, so blow your own trumpet wherever you can, but not so loudly, but honorably, humbly, and to the best of your to earn the respect from others. Okay, that's also a small story about this particular trumpet. I will not tell that now because there are two girls or three girls. Anyway, let me tell that.
So once I went to Washington D.C. and the ambassador was the famous Dhanapala the famous Dipper is my college mate and he was in fact that was the college mate by the same building. And both these people were very good at playing the trumpet. And you are this video, absolute joke. Right? So they had been a state function where he was invited, and that particularly there was a very important Sri Lankan minister there. Of course, he was a nice suit, prime suit, that's all. So they all went and had a good party, a garden party in the White House. And they had given a start of it. Because I saw his picture, right? So he had to be at least one of them. Yes, I saw a picture in the home with Bill Clinton and him playing the trumpet. Right? So he was a good friend of me. So after playing the trumpet, Bill Clinton had already kept it in a corner. There was a small nice stand, trumpet. Right? Nice stand where you keep the trumpet. So this fellow, after a couple of drinks, was like 9:60. And he wanted to, gentlemen, do this small thing, Hey, come on! Even if you have to come here, what kind of thing are you going to do in there? Yeah, I was like, this is big. They will go. Is that okay, sir? Are you going to come here? Good. So he goes. Now, look, ladies and gentlemen, go back to my love. All right. Stop it, my love. Right? He's of course told by that ambassador. I'm sure it was an absolute cock-up story. But he kept us laughing. Good.
So that is what twice people might do if you don't blow your own trumpet as engineers. There's a very old Hindu scriptures, you find this. So these are Vedic scriptures. I was told this is about 4,000 years old scripture. When there's harmony between the mind, the heart, and the resolution, then nothing is impossible. So we engineers should have the heart, the mind, and the resolution. resolve to do something. If you can do that, nothing is impossible for us as engineers in this country. Right? Nothing is impossible. I do believe this. Watch these two videos. Right? I hope this will work. Right.
Hi guys. Welcome to America's Got Talent.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Tell us a little bit about yourselves.
My name is Tao Pushon Lynch.
And my name is Varda. I'm 26 years old and she is?
96.
Wow. And you're going to be doing the act together. This is your...
Yes, we're going to do ballroom dancing together.
How did you meet each other?
Tinder.
So I was teaching one of my mambo classes and she just walked in to the studio, and from that day we've been dancing together for 6 years.
Oh wow. And you think that this is a $1 million act?
She's right next to me.
Oh, that's so nice. Okay, go for it. Enjoy yourselves.
Thank
Good
you.
Luck.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
'Cause anywhere else on television but America's Got Talent, and I loved it, and I'm going to start the voting. It's a yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
I have to say yes. It was great.
All right, well, you got 4 yeses. We will see you again.
It's about entertainment, and I know my parents will be sitting...
Stunned? 96 years. I think I saw her later on at 19 years also. Still she is living. She is the oldest yoga teacher in the world. Right, that lady? Stunned.
Thank you.
That fellow was 63 years old when he did that. You might have seen that fellow somewhere around. Right? Any guess? Who the fellow is? Okay. Then watch the last video for the day.
I can tell you that when I met the SIA pilots, I didn't meet them on TV. I met them face to face. So 5 feet across the table so they can see me and see whether I'm still vigorous, able to campaign and take them on, whether it's worth taking me on. And I offered them two choices. Either you argue, you stop this intimidation, which is what it was, bringing SIA right down, disrupting services, ruining its reputation, millions of dollars worth of advertisements and sales ruined within a matter of 2 weeks. I gave them a choice. Continue this, and I will, by every means at my disposal, teach you and get the people of Singapore, help me teach you a lesson you won't forget. And I'm prepared to start all over again. Or stop it. Get back to work, restore discipline, then argue your case. Took them 65 minutes. And they decided, okay, it isn't worth the fight. Why? Because they know they lose. They know that I'm prepared to ground the airline. They know that I can get the airline going again without them. And let there be no mistakes about this. Whoever governs Singapore must have that iron in him or give it up. This is not a game of cards. This is your life and mine. I've spent a whole lifetime building this. And as long as I'm in charge, nobody's going to knock it down.
Thank you very much. Can you all please keep your phones in the silent mode? I'm sure most of you would have watched this, some of these videos, but it shows the character of Lee Kuan Yew. Right? Singapore was thrown out of the Malayan Kingdom in 1965. And it was almost like a mud hole, entire Singapore. Right? In his own words, Singapore was a swamp. You know what a swamp is? Udrajwal? Nothing better than that. Singapore was full of gangsters. In fact, the first time I went to Singapore, that was in 1983. Even at that time, there were gangsters in Singapore. Right? He said he had few millions of people to account for. What can you learn from this man? You know, this is a person who is supposed to have said, he has never publicly admitted later on. In 1965 also when they got the independence or thrown out of the Malayan Kingdom, I will make Singapore like Ceylon. I don't think it was wrong because in 1948, when we got independence, Sri Lanka was only second to Japan in terms of economic prosperity. I will not answer any more queries. Where are we now? Can't we develop our own country? As I said before, if the engineers have the mind, the heart, and the resolve, we can do it. So I would say he was a man of immense courage, who never looked back on the mission, firm of his conviction, stayed focused, stayed away from all those who did not fall in line with him, with the commitment to rebuild the nation. Of course, there are a lot of stories about him putting a lot of his friends into the jail, right? Those are all history. Did not serve everyone with the same spoon. There's also a saying that if you try to please everyone, you will end up pleasing no one. The big problem with the Sri Lankans. We try to please everyone. Finally, what do? We finish up pleasing no one. There's a lot to learn from people of this caliber. One of my favorite quotes, I'm thankful for all those who said no to me. It is because of them I'm doing it myself. I'm going to say a few words about myself. Please pardon me. I'm not boasting. As I said before, if you don't blow your own trumpet, others will make it a spittoon. Please don't misunderstand. I don't know how many of you have heard about the Upper Kotme Hydropower Project. I just wrote, last few days I wrote about a certain history. The project was never to be started. There's so much of opposition. You would have heard about those who at least remember that era. There's so much of opposition. Until the first kilowatt hour was generated and dispatched, there was opposition. There was opposition. People tried to cripple the project. I did the studies in 1992. And finally, when I got the money to do it, it was 2002. Even then, we could not start the project until 2006. There's so much opposition. I don't think there have been ever such opposition in the next one was Noruchole. That also I did the studies. The 150 megawatt project cost us so much, and this history was stalled due to protest on environmental, socio political grounds. Right, commenced in 2006 and was commissioned in 2012. I would like you to go and see that project. It's a wonderful project, not because I did it. There are a lot of people who, along with me, who helped me to do it. Why did I do Upper Kotme Hydropower Project? In fact, the Japanese guy who, we got the money in 1995 to do the project. And we could not get the money. Finally, he went as a disappointed man, never to come back to Sri Lanka. But fortunately, when he started the project in 2002 or somewhere around 2006 or something, first contact was awarded in 2005. Fortunately, he was here. So he was here for the celebrations. And he said, I never ever thought this project will ever get off the ground. My guiding light was a quotation from the Bible. I'm a Christian. If you know what is right to do and not doing is a sin. You know what is right to do, not doing is a sin. You are committing a sin against the people. I knew doing Upper Kotme was the right thing to do, and I did it did not want to be a sinner. So I did it notwithstanding any obstacle, any impediment. No one believed that I will do it with so much of opposition. Mahamaranava, Apang Hirabuge Giditiba, Magandu Kadanai Giva. Parliament, if you come to Talwakala, I break your legs. Hari, one fellow came with a crowbar to hit me. Still, I survived. I was not afraid because I knew that I was doing the right thing. Some even wish that I fail. I thank them all. So I will not go any further. There are some more slides. Okay, now I turn to engineering. This is my main focus, right? What is engineer? Who is an engineer? What do you expect to do as an engineer? Are you prepared to face the challenges of engineering education, gain experience, and become a fully qualified professional engineer? That's what you are sitting for. You want to be a highly qualified, you are all qualified, right? You want to be a corporate member of the ISL, where you can truly say, now I am a professional engineer. Then you can also register with the ECSL. That is the trick why you are here today, most of you. Not that you didn't want to, you are a little lazy or whatever reason, you neglected. Right. There was a man by the name Herbert Clark Hoover. Right? This man was, those days they were going in steamships. It took about 2 months to cross the Atlantic from London to New York. He was a New Yorker. The lady was a Britisher, right? So they met in the ship and they befriended each other. They became very good friends. They used to dance in the evening and they used to have meals together. Right? Don't ask me anything else. Okay? So finally, when they were sitting for the last breakfast, they saw the New York Harbor ahead and they were bidding goodbye. Then the lady had a burning question to ask this fellow. What was the question? Anybody? So they asked in very nice language. They said, "I hope you will forgive my dreadful curiosity, but I should like to offer you to know what." I should like to offer you to know what.
What is here? Who you are? Anything else? Anything else? Reason or it? Reason or it? Who you are? I think I'm not going to say anything that I don't think later. I don't say that. Sing an idea. Hear that, please. You. You sing it. Any other? What is that you ask? The lady asked. First two rows in the ear. Come on. What did he ask? What she asked? This is the question she asked. Immediately, she said, "I am an atheist." You know what I mean? The face said, "Make that the government and I am a chitra." Oh my God. You look at me. She snapped back and said, I thought you were a gentleman. What does it mean? Those days, engineers were not considered to be gentlemen. Why? Because they were smelling.
They always wore overalls. They had dirty hands. They were rough, tough, often spoke in full filth, and had very bad mannerisms. Therefore, they were not recognized in society. So engineers were not recognized in society at that time. They thought they were just like mechanics, you know, grease monkeys. But now, the engineers are held in very high esteem. We are recognized in society. We are clean hands. We wear perfume. We are good mannerisms. The society look up to us. So do we behave in that manner? Please read that notice and come. Read that notice and come. Yeah. So the society look up to them as engineers. But do we live up to that? If society is looking up to us, are we living up to that? අර මහත්තයාට තේරෙන්නේ two front seats කියලා two back seats කියලා. Rows කියලා. ඉස්සර දෙකක් තියෙනවා තව සීට් තියෙනවා ගෙන්නේ. Right. Incidentally, that particular man, Herbert Clark Hoover, became the 31st president of the United States of America. The only president who was an engineer. The Hoover Dam is built after his name. Right? So I'll go a little faster. Who is an engineer? An engineer is a professional practitioner of engineering concerned with applying scientific knowledge and mathematics. and ingenuity to develop solutions for technical problems. Engineers design materials, structures, machines and systems while considering the limitations imposed by practicality, safety and cost. I would now add the words environment. The word engineer is derived from the Latin root ingenium, meaning cleverness. So you guys, and I do, me included, we are clever people. We are extremely clever people. I always tell this, if you have passed the Sri Lankan A level and got into the university and got an engineering degree, I don't think we are second to anybody in our intellectual capacity in this country. They passed through some of the toughest exams on earth, especially the Sri Lankan A level. One of the worst you can ever think of. Right? So we are very clever guys. If you all are clever guys, what do? If you are clever, what do? You pat your back, right? Just pat out there. Pat your back, man. Nobody's going to pat your back. So we are clever people. Keep that in mind. First and foremost, you all are clever people. To begin with, you all are clever. Now we add up certain things thereafter. Experience and all kinds of that kind of things comes after that. Engineers are grounded in applied sciences and their work in research and development is distinct from the basic research focus of scientists. Scientists do a lot of research, right? If you ask a scientist when the bottle is full, what is the weight on this 500 ml? What is the weight on this bottle? Full of water. So scientists are basically different to engineers, right? We are practical people. The work of engineers forms the link between the scientific discoveries and the applications that meet the needs of the society. If you are not willing to meet the needs of society as engineers, forget engineering. You are now, it's not too late to try to forget engineering. I have known few engineers have given up their jobs and gone into robes. And they are monks today. They are monks. Very good. Why? At least they will do something for their own self in the next life. If you engineers don't do what you are supposed to do, I know what's going to happen to your next life. You are obliged to do the last bit. Meet the needs of society. All our work, remember, is to meet the needs of society. Of course we get a salary. Decent salary to live. Otherwise, we can't be living. I mean, at least having some right existence. So we need a salary. But for that, we have to do something for the society, not for yourself. For yourself, you can do it with your money. There was a central focus of engineering profession is the application of scientific knowledge to meet the societal needs. So it's that intersection that matters. That is where we are. We got to have very good science and basic scientific and mathematical knowledge, and we are supposed to be doing what the society needs us to do. Nothing else. On the other hand, we are human beings, right? So we have our own creativity, we have our own analytical skills. Some of us have a lot of creativity, some of us have a lot of analytical skills. And nothing wrong. We are human beings, right? After now, my daughter, second daughter, highly creative person. Even when she was about 6-7 years old, she used to make beautiful things. I can't do that. That's her creativity. So just like that, there will be a lot of people here who are highly creative. There will be also a lot of people here who can think a lot and build up models in your head when you want to apply engineering to the workplace, to the job at hand. So we are a mixture of people who are having a lot of creativity, a lot of analytical skills, but at the same time, don't forget, we have to meet the needs of society with scientific knowledge. For example, as engineers apply commercial software to solutions of an engineering problem, the application of analytical skills per se may involve very little creativity. You have been doing these things. I'm going to tell you what you are doing. Isn't that so? You sit behind a computer, you model the whole thing, right? And put in numbers, crunch the numbers, you get some answer, it doesn't look correct. You change the parameters, increase safety margin, decrease safety margin, do all kinds of things. That's pure analytical working. On the other hand, engineers may design ergonomic office space with very little analytical skills. Now you have office space, and put everything there. Where the analytical skills come in? No, it's your creative skill that will come in there to make that space as useful and livable as possible. Hence, let us look at engineering from all these perspectives. So finally, though we say that we are all same, not all same, we fall into either A, B, C or category. One of the three categories. There are engineers who are highly analytical, there are engineers who are highly creative, there are engineers who are both analytical and creative together. I'm going to ask these questions, and of course time is running up. We had to do cover a lot of ground today. Just think for yourself. If we don't have a lot of engineers with a lot of analytical skills, God forbid, what happened in Kandy a couple of days ago will be happening everywhere. Thanks to those engineers who are doing their designs properly, thankfully in Sri Lanka, not like, I'll show you some of the pictures later on. There's a country that almost every week there's a building collapsing. Right? Thankfully, we are not in that kind of countries, but now it's getting a little dangerous because we see a lot of buildings collapsing even in Sri Lanka, starting from about 2 or 3 years ago, the Velvet debacle. So better be careful. Do your job properly. And also, if you don't have the creativity, where are those Krish towers and the nice buildings that are coming up here? You'd all look like palm petty. If I had the good fortune to go to Germany, just after the wall was brought down, Berlin Wall, so these people took me to the eastern side of Berlin Wall. It was a world of a difference. On this side of Berlin Wall, on the western side, the buildings are beautiful, marvelous. The moment you cross, you see only Kochi Petty. Tower buildings, just blocks. But their creativity was not allowed to come out. Both are Germans. Both sides of the divide, they had Germans. What are the difference? Their creativity was not allowed to come out. So the three aspects of engineering, sector A represents the intersection of purely analytical talents within the engineering domain. This may be used to represent the engineering science and ability to model complex systems and predict their responses to various inputs under various conditions. Isn't that so? That's what you're doing all the time, right? We change the environment, we change the loading, we change this, that and the other, try out what's going to come out, right? This segment of engineering has, of course, been the subject of intense development over the last half century and has benefited most directly from the availability of fast digital computers. When I studied at Mushta Moratuwa, there were one main frame, so about IBM 1130 or something, so about, one-eighth of this room, big, and it did not have even the computer power that you are having in any of the smallest calculators. Not smallest, of course, scientific calculators. That's all it could do, right? But now see the amount of number crunch you can do. So I asked one of the civil engineers. I was told that Jethavana Rame is the tallest brick building in the world. I don't know if it's true. I was told. So when I was working at Nerd Center, there was another guy who was trying to analyze this shear and the stress and all kinds of forces in the brick buildings. So I asked him casually, how long could it have been for this building to be, this Jethavana to be designed? He said, easily 40 years. And I said, if now you are given the task of designing the brick building for the brick Jethavana Rame, how long it will take? He thought for a while and said, maybe about 4 hours maximum. These are just ballpark figures. Isn't that so? You can get an answer in a jiffy. Right? Sector C, the intersection of our creative capacity with the engineering domain can be viewed as representing those sudden intuitive leaps, often responsible for revolutionary advances in technology, called significant novelty. Novel things. You can't think about it. I mean, normal man can't think about these things. It just comes automatically through intuition. No one has taught them, right? As well as those aspects of engineering not yet fully supported by engineering science that remain more an art than science. So, the little bit of artistic talent that is in us, and it works. But I don't say that you should work only with art, right? You'd also be able to support that with some kind of engineering judgment, some calculations. That's what you do. So sector B, the intersection of knowledge and the need with both creative and analytical capability, can be used to represent the engineering design and much real world problem solving. This sector includes activities ranging from developing innovative products and processes to creating an innovative bridge design, to develop a new control process for petrochemical production, and so on and so forth. I don't know how many of you have been to Japan. When you go to Tokyo, there's a cruise that you can take over the, there's a bridge, there's a river. When you go on that river cruise, you can see about 38 or 39 different bridges, designs. Marvelous, beautiful. But all of them carry the same load. Their creativity is at a maximum, right? So they show that. So I'll not go through this. Of course, there are other things. You can perhaps get a copy of this presentation. Engineers, therefore, are creative problem solvers. How many of you are electrical engineers here? Show your hands. Three, six, seven. I'm also electrical. We are clever, right? Electrical engineers are clever, isn't it? Not like these fellows, they can't think like that. Okay. So we are creative problem solvers. We can solve any problem. Let me tell you that. There's no problem that engineers cannot solve. If you cannot solve any problem that you think as insurmountable, you're not fit to be an engineer. When I say that, of course, I'm very mindful. You can't solve a problem and say that when I throw a ball, it should go up and up and up and go to the moon. That's nonsense. We know if you throw a ball up, it'll come down. So within those limits, we know we can solve problems. That is what engineering is all about. We are there to solve complex engineering problems. That is the definition of an engineer, as given by the International Engineering Alliance. Go look up IEA.com. Please look up International Engineering Alliance. We are fortunately a member of the International Engineering Alliance, IESA, among very few countries, maybe less than 30. In the whole world, we are members. You should be proud to be a member of the IESA. Germany has been trying their best, they can't get it. There are so many other countries have been trying their best, they can't get it. We are one among the USA, Canada, Ireland, England, South Africa, Korea, Japan, Hong Kong, Singapore, Malaysia, not even Indonesia, Russia, India. India became after us, right? India, and so many other countries. We are one among them, ISL. Right? So be proud to be a member of the ISL and you are trying to become professional engineer, full corporate member. So I'll skip these, these are definitions, but I'll show this one. This one says, we are we belong to that category. Who are watching record category. It says, apply knowledge of mathematics, science, engineering fundamentals, and an engineering specialization, blah, 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 respectively, to the solution of complex engineering problems. That's the point. You look at the other three. Two. These are technologists. Sydney part 3 year graduates of engineering. These are technicians. They have the same background. Science majority. But they apply their engineering knowledge, define and apply engineering procedures and processes. They are already defined. So they tackle design. We tackle complex engineering problems, which means problems that cannot be solved by anyone else. That's what they are used for. If anybody can solve our problem, why should we need engineers? Why do you want to invest on engineers? Basuna can solve it. You see what happens when Basuna has to work, right? I'm going to show some pictures. Okay, I'll stop at that. Right, okay, this one I want to show. Once again, the last, the topmost column, it says, is a graduate at Queen's College, right? Cannot be resolved, is a complex engineering problem, cannot be resolved without in-depth engineering knowledge at the level of the fact, which allows two keywords that allow most, two keywords that allow most. Fundamental base, first principle. I'm happy most of you are being mature, right? Now, if you talk to some of the young engineers of Bangalore University, they are not taught fundamentals of engineering. Sorry to say, I'm not reading through university. They don't know how to solve problems using first principle. They only know how to use Excel. Tools. You ask them a question, I don't blame them at all. I don't blame them at all. But what I tell them is, please, even after you graduate, you are studying your fundamentals and you cannot solve some of the problems without knowing your fundamentals. Right? You can always ask me a question, right? What do we need our engineers to be? Listen with an open mind. Listen with an open mind. Speak up when required. Ogoludan speak up karanne wenaya metana. How many times I ask you questions, you don't speak. Right? Speak up. What's wrong with that? But speak up, man. If you don't speak up, others will speak on your behalf. That is what has been happening in this country. We don't speak up. Others speak up on our behalf. Don't allow that to happen. Always be in a talking mood. Be ready to talk. Do not rush in words, but speak sense. My next lecture, I'll be talking about how to speak sense and write for others to understand. That will be the last lecture for you all. Right? Write well. Clear and logical writing. In whatever they write, you have to be fiercely careful about accuracy. That was one of my bosses who always told me, Shavi, be very careful. You can say anything you like, but you commit to writing, be extremely careful what you write. What you write, you cannot retract. What you say, you can say, no, I didn't say that. Because you are liar. So what? You are lying like I'm not saying you like, right? But if you say something that always I say, I'm sorry, I regret that. You hurt someone, you can say, I'm sorry. But you write something on paper and put it down. That will be held against you until you withdraw that letter in writing. Can we take a vote? As evidence. Better be very careful on what happens. That doesn't mean that you don't write. You have write something, but better be careful what you write is absolutely correct. Think about it several times before you commit it. Good manners. They're very courteous and well mannered. If there's time, I'll even show you how to dress it. Only for the males. Huh? I don't know how to dress women. I'm not a woman. Right? Hey, well mannered. Dress well. Be smartly dressed to suit the occasion. I am not telling that you have to go for a party in the evening with a nice tie and you know, hey, mama engineer.
So that is nonsense. Party or party is not. But when you go for a business meeting, be properly dressed.
Don't go shabby dressed. The people look at you, judge you, and you will have a very bad opinion about you and your organization that you represent. That is the problem. Not only you. I'm not saying that you had to get the best of 10,000 rupee, 15,000 rupee shirts. I rarely buy them. Never, in fact. I try to keep it less than now, 5,000, 6,000 at the bare minimum. Hurry. I don't buy these fancy shirts for 15,000, 20,000. Right? But be properly dressed. Read well. I have been telling all my subordinates, as engineers, there are two things that you have to do. Compulsory. You go to the field 50%. Spend time in your office 50%, not jabbering with the neighbor, or cracking jokes, or sending vulgar jokes in the front. Read. When you say read, it doesn't mean to say that, you know, we have to read textbooks or whatever. Read letters that come to your table. Read letters that you write and sign. Read specifications that come on your table. There's a guy whom I caught. I gave him book in my project, right? To read and clear the specifications. And after he did that, fortunately I gave it to his boss. He just skimmed through. Oh my God, he came and told me, this fellow has not even read half the specifications. It's tiresome. Boring, sickening, but looking for a job and tendering for a job, we are not familiar with what is written in that, in small print or big print or whatever print. Even the drawings and the figures. You, that can cost you millions of rupees. That can even cost you a job. So don't forget to read. Reading is absolutely important. And there, even there are still a lot of media, and you must also read and understand some of the things that are happening in the world. Right? So at least listen to the news channels. That is some kind of reading, absorbing. Journals. As a practice, on one day of the month, I used to call all my juniors, and they used to get all kinds of journals, you know, engineer journal, and they subscribe to all those international, we in CV, we pay the international Institute of Engineers, whatever institution they want to have, one institution abroad, they sign up, and we pay the subscription, quite expensive. So they get all the free journals. What happens? අර පොඩි උන්ට කුටු ගන්න දෙනවා කෑලි කපලා දෙනවා ස්ක්‍රැප් බුක් වල අරවන්න I said if you get any books you read them and I'll pick up an article and I'll ask you to explain to your colleagues so that way they got the habit of reading and some of those are very very interesting what's happening around the world Right? So no shortcuts. No shortcuts. Believe me, no shortcuts. Read. As they later can give. Kia wanda pa vino. Nattang engineer job beka hariyani ne. Work hard. No excuse to working hard. Right. Are you ready for this challenge? Are you?
Are you? Yes.
Are you prepared? Are you prepared? I don't know if you're going to know anything. Right? That is a formidable task, my dear friends. That's a formidable task. You have no option. Fight it out. Fight out that man out there. That's the challenge you are having. Make no mistake. It's as onerous as that. It's as difficult as that. Now, when you face a challenge, there are two things you must do. When you face a challenge, there are two things you must do. You must first think. They must first think, face the challenge confidently, thinking, let me. Okay, you hear me? All right? It's okay? I asked him to turn down, but it's all right? So when you face the challenge confidently, thinking, if I can't, who can? Mata karanna berinam methana ekek na karanna. Mata me job e karanna berinam ekek na. Take up the challenge thinking, if I can't, who can? Take the challenge like that. And once you accomplish the job, be humble enough to say, if I can, who can't? That's the principle that is embedded in some of the clauses in the ethics. Our peers, our subordinates, we must train them to do what we did. Guru Mushtiya Danginipa. Oh never can a cow kill them. There are a lot of engineers.
I don't know why. Maybe they fear that others will compete with them. Right? They think only we know the sun. Others can't even understand. So when the summer class sometimes is summer days come and ask me, they just give a shoddy answer. He goes and does something, doesn't work, comes and asks him, he gives another shoddy answer. You know what's going to happen? Don't understand this fellow, even the small bosses, but they are very knowledgeable. Right? Those who are coming from a technical background, they know what they are talking about, right? Very soon, they will not ask you anymore. They will tell everybody, you know very well, but if you pretend that you want to give some other answer, devious answer, they quickly catch that and they start talking about you behind your back and say, he is a useless person. So why? They are not going to compete with you. Even if supported, they are not going to compete with you. So share your knowledge with everybody. That's one of the most important things after becoming a professional engineer. It's already written into the code of ethics. It's already written into the code of ethics. I'm sure you read the code of ethics. If I can't, if I can, who can't? Now get on to the professional review examination proper. IESL tests the candidate on professional experience and knowledge on general issues faced by engineers and the society they work in. It consists of three things. The viva voce. You have heard the word viva. In Latin it means tell it in words. Viva voce means tell it in words. Even yesterday we had a meeting here going through the PR rules. And I had to give a brief explanation what you have, why you have this, all these three components. You wonder why. If you cannot express yourself for what you are capable of doing, expressing yourself is useless. That's what you call a four-quadrant communication, right? You should be able to explain what you are doing to your bosses. You should be able to explain what you are doing to your subordinates. You should be able to explain what you are doing to the peers. Three quadrants. What is the fourth? What is the fourth? What is the fourth? What is the fourth? Anyone? So that the stakeholders. You should be able to explain what you are doing to your stakeholders. So that he said it very well. I'm happy about it. Right? Bosses, subordinates, peers, and the society. All the stakeholders in our case. So if you can't do that, why should you give you the charter? I'm sure you can do that. Looking at you, I know that you are good, you are very capable of doing that. Then we also give you another paper just after the, so this was questioned yesterday. Why do you want to give the A paper when you have already found out what they are capable of? I said no. You have to have the A paper. You know what the A paper is about? Immediately after the interview, we draft two questions and give you. Right? Now these two questions generally, this is the way I set it. I give a very particular problem that you have grappled in your day-to-day work. And another general one, which is judge your capability of tackling a general problem of which you are competent. If you are a telecommunication engineer, I will not give you a question in power engineering. If you are a power engineer, I will not give a question to you in telecommunication. Right? So once again, you express yourself in writing. The third one that you are going to face in a few weeks' time is the B paper.
I'm very happy that last time the B paper results were very good. That's why the B paper results were very good. Now next lecture I'll show you some of the answers. Right? In their own handwriting I'll show you some of the answers. The B paper is aimed at testing the candidate's knowledge on engineers' role in the society and general affairs. And you know that, okay, let me come to the structure later on. What do we examine at ISL B paper? It's not similar to the Engineering Society paper of UK, which are very extensive, a lot of analytical stuff. So actually, B paper is quite easy compared to the Engineering Society UK Engineering Council paper. One thing, they are a little bit away from the Sri Lankan context. I don't know how many of you have done the Engineering Society Council paper. Is there anybody who has done that? It's quite tough. We at IESL call it the B paper. And it tests the knowledge on general issues faced by engineers and the society they work in. They are trying to give you a contextual relationship to the society that we are living in Sri Lanka. You should know something about Sri Lanka. Know what is happening in the country right now. Big projects, small projects, shelf projects, dash projects. Now yesterday I think there was a letter that went to the RDA. You are from RDA, right? Was it RDA or SLR? I don't know. To someone, as the Minister of, Secretary of Transport, that said that the light rail project should be cancelled or something to that effect. JICA or that? Sorry? Give the funding.
Fund,
yeah. Somehow. Right, okay. So these kind of things you should be aware. Why? As he said, you had to find out why it was chilled, why it was cancelled. What repercussions it will have, what benefits it have had, whether too costs, too much of costs and benefits are not balanced. You don't know, I don't know. I frankly don't. I'm not from this sector, but I will have to find out from tomorrow onwards. You know the reason why? As engineers, all of us go for parties, weddings, funerals. So they know that we are engineers. Haven't you come across people who have come and ask you? You can be a power engineer, you can be a telecom engineer, you can be RD engineer, you can be anybody engineer. For them, engineers are engineer. They will ask you, what happened? JICA cancelled it. Why? What happened that August 17th? CB blundered, no? Why? Don't they come and ask you? They expect you to know something. You will not be expert. You should never give a ruling. I have heard a lot of people telling all kinds of stories about the power sector without understanding a thing. You can give an opinion or you can raise questions. That's perfectly all right. But to give and say, you know these CB fellows, you know, they did not do this thing properly, you know. That fellow, as if that guy, switch it. The Nangala Giani Machang, it is. Alanda Dibuni Machang. If again, no, at least to some extent, you should have a good knowledge of what's happening in the country. The people expect you to know something. Not only because of that, in a responsible way, we should know how to analyze even this particular problem. If that problem is good, I'm sure there will be a question on that, I suppose. Right? I'm not sure. I'm not one of his examiners. Right? You should be able to write a good essay on that. With this light rail, what would happen? Without that, what could happen? What are the other alternatives? That kind of thing, you should have a good hang of the problem. Because the problem is in Sri Lanka, you can be a water engineer, you can be a road engineer, you can be a telecom engineer, you can be a power engineer. We interact so much with each other. especially when you're working in the society. We have to understand what the civil engineers are doing in the road sector.
We have to understand what the water works engineers are doing in the, by digging the roads and doing all the micro-tunneling and all those things. It's a great thing. What's happening in the tunnel? What is that project? How many of you know that? You interact, right?
So you should have a good knowledge of it. Right. But we have a syllabus, which is very wide, very wide. The goods and the bads of being the syllabus so wide. And relate to day-to-day issues we as engineers face in society. How many of you have looked at the B papers, past B papers? Anybody, please put your hands up. Ayyo. Oma korla nam bae pass wenna. Therunada? Yan lamai ni. උයන් නැතිනවා ගෙදර ගියාම නේද ආ පිච්චර් බලන්න තියන ටීවී බලන්න තියන රන්දපෑ බලන්න තියනවා අර ෆේස්බුක් යන්න තියනවා නැද්ද කොච්චර ඇරතිල ගෙදර ගියාමනේ මේ වේ වලෝ නරකයි පොඩ්ඩක් මේ කරන්න තියෙන තසුමාන දෙකයි මම දෙකයි තුනයි මම දන්නේ when have a look man please And try to do some of those questions. You get a good feeling of how to write this paper. Give answers to the paper. Have you gone through the lectures done last year? All these are in the YouTube. Yes, sir. So go and look at some of these things, especially the ones that you are not familiar with. Right? Economy, foreign relations. I don't know if that is still there. Right and environment they are not subject that we generally come across no? but if we have to answer some of these questions and you are stuck we don't have the facts with you god bless you it's going to be tough for you so there's enough time for you to do that now facebook patra dala okkom patra dala araka balan right Are you aware of the structure of B paper? I'm sure you are aware. Have you gone through some of the past papers and attempt to do them? What about Kuppi? You do it Kuppi in campus?
Pathi Kathiri. Especially if you are in the provinces. The good place for you to get together is the evening. Especially if you are in the country, get together with the civil engineer. Mechanical engineer. Chemical engineer. Material engineer. And check. Fix the time. What are you going to make your deal? And have a good conversation, take some papers and go through with them and ask what do you think about this, or how to tackle this. What do you have? Do you have written about this? I'm telling you because I have an exam. The level has been a door. I can't ever imagine. So these are the kind of engineers who are writing these papers. Of course, this time it's very important. 80% pass mark. 80% for the first time in history. The last time I gave a challenge, show me 70%. So we are still going on 60%. That means most of you are quite mature and been in the field for quite some time. You have no problem answering this. But don't relax like this being an actor. Dagger now, first we get up to 100, 150, no loss. 150, no loss, target is 175, 159, all out. That's it. This is healthy, right? Don't relax. Don't be overconfident. That can be very tricky questions. Right? So have some kuppi. No problem. The B paper structure. I want to tell this because I have seen it. People are making a lot of mistakes.
I'm sure none of you are going to make the mistake, but I want to make sure that you don't make that mistake. The paper is in two sections. Section one has only two questions, and that's on ethics. What Russell, I think he had on Monday, Russell De Silva. Select only one. I've seen some people selecting two questions from section one. It have been just a mistake, you know. Now you have no excuse because you have heard me telling, don't answer more than one question from section one. Right? So written B paper would be 3 hours duration, will consist of two sections. Section one will be on engineering ethics and code of conduct, while section two will be on topics based on issues taking place in society, both local and foreign. In other words, other spheres other than engineering as well that has a direct impact on the society. Foreign policy has a direct impact on the society. Foreign trade has a direct impact on the society. Right? You don't know what we have heard about Geneva, their threat to curtail our exports, all that kind of thing. You have heard about it, no? So far, nothing has happened. Thankfully, if something like that happens, we learn bitter lessons. Right? So you should understand these things. I quite agree that some of us don't understand what is happening in the world. So I associate a lot of engineers. And some of the things that they talk about, I feel very sorry. They sometimes talk like children, right? What they have heard from their wives or husbands or their children, they come and repeat. Achang, I heard like this, so Achang, it's true. Right? So better be careful. We want you to be responsible, because once you get a charter, right? You are held in very high esteem. And out of the question section two, now there's no hard and fast rule, right? You can select any three questions from section two. There are some general topics and there are some specific topics. Specific topics related to specific fields. Road sector, water sector, telecom sector, power and energy sector. So sometimes you can't escape. You have to answer something. So that's why I'm warning you a lot. Please look at the past question papers. And if you don't know that subject, you may be having a lot of batchmates, a lot of friends who are in the road sector or water sector or power sector or whatever. Have a discussion. Have a chat. There's nothing wrong in that. The other questions, yeah. So let me read that. What out of the questions in section two, some of the questions will be topics of general nature, with specific knowledge about the area subject to the question is not necessarily required. You don't have to read economics books to answer economics. You don't have to be a diplomat to answer questions on foreign policy. You should have good general knowledge, good hang of the issues, right? That's what is expected of you to do. Where the candidates are usually asked to analyze, express opinions, comment, give their own views, and elaborate a certain issue on certain issues taking place in the society. A candidate who is generally sensitive to what is taking place around him or her, and who can form his own opinion about them, should be able to answer these questions without difficulty. So what we are expecting you as engineers to do, form your own opinion. It need not necessarily be the opinion of even the examiner. I have marked some of the questions, answered questions, I have marked questions. And some of the problems that I am giving, I have my own variable and done very good. Some people write completely opposite to what I am saying. I still be marked.
Like in case I wish I could have told that and you know that I got it from you know that. But that the person who wrote that was so good, so logical is to our thinking, that person got 80% mark for that particular question. Though personally I do not like what that person was writing. That is how most of the examiners mark it. Because it means you should be able to form your own judgment and your feeling. But you can't have, illogical things. You can't write things that are out of the bounds of the past. In fact, I'm wrong, in the book. The other lecture here. This was a little different. Who came and gave a lecture? God said that. How to predict Gurukarma? I was sitting here. How to predict the inflow? I'm not saying he's better off. Based on He will be convinced. But the problem is, there have been a lot of young engineers who have thought, oh my god, that's fantastic. I don't need to learn about the stochastic forecast. I don't need to use the statistics. I now go and look at the list. And look at the Raja Rai. And predict my what? The facts. Right? That is not acceptable in this thing. Maybe you may have your, I'm not discounting. If you are a clear one as well, okay, that's, I could respect you. That's your job. I also have my own supposition. All of us have our own, nobody in this world. I mean, sometimes. Sometimes when I see the serving mark, sometimes I get elected to get it. Right? That is correct. If you are a teacher, 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 you comes to reports that are going to be looked at by other people, you cannot write things that you believe in. Are you scared? I can't write and say, God told me to do that, God told me to do all of this, and God told me what I didn't do all of this. That is my own prediction, my own meaning, that's a different fact. I can write a statement like this. Right? That's what I'm saying, that's all I'm saying. But that, okay, mind you, there's a fantastic, fantastic task of it. Fantastic. First time I ever seen that kind of answer. Right? Have you ever heard of mind map? I've heard of it. This is what I saw on Facebook. I give it up, description. That person on the first day drew the entire mind map, like profile. When I saw that, I thought, my God, fantastic. I'm going to see a fantastic with the paper, half a day, half a day. Can I be marked? If that person really excited me for a very good answer. That's nonsense. People write in good forms, people don't give marks. Right? You are writing an essay. And you get to bullet here and there. But some people write the entire answer to be bullet form. You don't give marks. Don't make a mistake.
they read. Right? Candidates are required to answer four questions, selecting one from section 1 and three from section 2. Candidates can select any mix of questions irrespective of the type in the section 2. Each question will have carry 25 marks and the pass mark is 50. IESL will be testing you on communication skills. The art of communicating clearly, concisely, intelligibly, unfortunately in English. English is not our mother tongue. I'll talk about that in the next class. The art of structuring an answer. I'm going to talk about that next lecture. How you structure the answers. The beginning, the body, and the conclusion. The presentation and the flow. Transition from one point to another. Transition from one point to another. Proper use of paragraphs. Writing grammatically correct English. Spellings. And most important thing, writing answers to the point. Sometimes I get answers, where are you going, coconut in the basket? There was an answer given, but conflict resolution. Right? Actually that person, after doing the exam, right, the exam question, he died. So I had to look up at his papers. So I looked at his, lecture, and I knew what he was looking at, and I used to have to mark his mistake. There were conflict resolution. One of the techniques that he has described in conflict resolution was connecting. Right? This particular answer, there was a problem given, and he was asked to calculate the right term, how we would solve conflict. Very interesting, COVID attack, working life. Entire 2 pages writing how to call a meeting, how to get the attendance, because that person also told how to do that, how to get them to sit, how to take down notes, who will take down notes, how the president or the chairperson conduct the meeting, and that's all. In fact, you know, that's all. So the person has missed the point. Focus on the point that the examiner is trying to elicit from you. That's you. If very carefully, the question will say so many things. But at some point, the examiner is going to focus on what you are supposed to answer. So pick that up very well. Concentrate on that. Keep your eyes focused on that. You can write a lot of things, but always focus on this is what is asked. This is what I have learned. If you don't do that, you can't score marks. You can write a lot of things, but if you don't focus on what is expected of you from that particular question, you're not going to get marks. Ethics and code of conduct. Of course, there are a lot of publications. There are a lot of literature on ethics and code of conduct in the internet. If you look at Engineering Council UK, there are volumes of e-literature on code of conduct. If you look at National Society of NSPA, USA, a whole lot of literature on code of ethics. And that some of those code of ethics are almost identical to the Sri Lankan code of ethics. Read some case studies. Right? You get a lot of inspiration how to turn out your code of ethics question to express your opinion and your judgment and your way you look at it in solving problems using code of ethics. And please go through them very carefully. That's a very important section. Even if you pass, try few questions, and if you write that, you will be a very competent engineer just by doing that, right? Then the issues affecting society, social, economic, political factors, gender issues, behavioral sciences, national development, industry, commerce, role and responsibility of the engineer as a member of the society and as a professional. Now, being a member of society, you can be very good, nice man, right? But being an engineer in the society and being nice is different, right? Just think about it. You can be a very responsible, very popular guy in your down your street, down your road, right? But being an engineer and being that is more challenging. I'm sure you have attended this Maranadhara Society in Nepuluang, or Gamegudi in Tharuna Samiti in Nepuluang. I was in my Tharuna Samiti for a long time, right? And many cultural societies. Because the problem is they look up to you. They know that you know something more than them. Therefore, you have more responsibility to work like an engineer, professional engineer, even when you work in society. They're different, right? Then public perception of engineers, strengths, opportunities and threats to the profession, role of civil society, environmental issues, emerging technologies. Some of these things are not being tested very well in some of these questions. International affairs, government national policy, and Sri Lankan economy, major infrastructure projects taking place and planned for the future. Also listen to the lectures on specific topics arranged by the IESL from time to time, and in this series of lectures and last few years on which few questions will be directly based upon. I've seen some of the questions. They sometimes take questions from some of the lectures that they have done. Why do candidates fail in the BPO? The real reason. Candidates do not work hard and prepare adequately to meet the requirements as you did in your school, university, ISL examinations. You just take it, okra and plumber. That attitude. And when you see the paper, Dadi Dagan Natamandakali. No stuff. The words are not coming. Why? There's nothing here. You're not ready now. Are a port city project and a put the kills from Mikron toys at the dinner ready? Are a Umay going to put the Mahanadimana? Are by Bajakuti I cast it? Put a Kataka Laguna anyway? Don't leave room for that. You have about 3-4 weeks, right? Huh? 1 week only. So work hard, hard and harder. When is the exam? 4th of October. Why did they wait all this time to start these lectures? I should have told this to you 1 month ago, right? Isn't that so? I told this to you 1 month ago. If I told you, I'm sure you'd have done a lot of work, right? They do not read technical literature. National newspapers even, international journals are simply not interested in topics other than their own area of specialty. I had a fellow who could not pass the BPA for a long time. Brilliant engineer in CEB. Now he knew only the subject that he was doing. Brilliant, first class. First class, I mean, literally first class in the bench. Problems faced by candidates. The problems faced by candidates and their weakness have been identified to be the following. Poor reading habits, lack of knowledge of common affairs, especially politics, economics, and social issues. Inability to correctly understand the question. I told this before. Inability to structure a response to a question. Inability to write clearly and concisely. Concise means don't try to write too many words, but it can't be too less words either. I would suggest at least 2.5 pages minimum. Minimum. Please keep that in mind, right? That means you have to have a lot of facts. You have a lot of facts. 2 minutes to 2.5 pages. You know the problem? There's a sponge here. You don't have that one. You have like, right? Problems with English language. It's too late for you to do anything now. If you find that English language is your problem, you come to my next lecture, I'll tell you how to improve that. To overcome these problems, a series of lectures are conducted about 3 months before the IU. 1 month. 1 week before PR examination. I'm wrong. I hope that this series of lectures and interaction with eminent resource persons will help candidates to overcome their weaknesses before the examination and enable them to face the paper with a great degree of confidence. IESL will do its part. What do you have to do? Attend these lectures as much as possible. If you miss them, look it up in the website. Read articles of national interest, especially on engineering-related issues and issues that impact the national economy, international relations, environment, etc. Attempt the past papers and write answers to those questions and check with the resource persons if they would like to give feedback on your answers. I don't think there's any time for you to do that. I have done a lot of people have sent me the answers and I have corrected and sent them back. I don't send them because I am very busy these days. One or two I can tolerate. Right? If you can told on my email address, I'll do my best to give your feedback. Your answers, I will most certainly do so in my subject area. I'm a power engineer, so if you have any questions or something, send me a question, I'll give a brief reply. If you are not quite competent in English, please follow an English course. English is not our mother tongue. Remember that. It's very difficult. We always... Okay, look at these awful pictures. I told you. Who is responsible? Electrical short circuit. Who is responsible? Who? Electrical engineers. Here in the back. Only 5 of us are here. Don't blame the civil engineers, huh? Don't blame the civil engineers. But this? I don't think so, because civil engineers are dead and gone, those who built that. Who are responsible? Anybody? Anybody? Huh? Engineers in which sector? No? No? Come on! Regulations that way? The local authority engineers? They have... I mean, the building is not the local... I mean, they should be able to maintain. The building is not safe, get out. You are not supposed to live in this building. Right? The regulations are there. Are you following those regulations for the buildings? Right? You can say building engineers or whatever engineers. Haha. These are the countries that I told you about. One of the worst engineering disasters. 1,100 people died. Make with Dunnal. Bangladesh. You know, we came from, there's a King Vijay came from West Bengal. Apito again. Wakarunam apgi balanda me mekala. අර මේ ළඟදි මොකද්ද දවස FB some notice it said that somebody was getting hammered or something they were taking selfies of pictures and that poor fellow died they are not even maybe accident or something not even give a call to 119 and save that fellow have you taken pictures camera one video karanne oy daanne tv ara mokak dan thiyenawane you can send a video to the tv fellows so they are very keen to get the video capture the video and they are not inform the people to take this fellow to the hospital or something fellow died sakala perin siri sri lankawai bangladesh deka me this in china bridge collapsing this was in one of the sri lankan newspapers with a funny joke what is this me koida mahatya rda mahatya me koida kore gena ba ne this dharne gala bridge see loriya pitimma palle hari gilla balanna ape bisu balang illa asaru right so I am just joking me like we are all curious yeah you can give any excuse but engineers are responsible once again I told you I start off by saying don't blame the politicians
don't tell this fellow didn't do that that fellow didn't do that right
it's our responsibility until something is done you all must do everything possible within your means to do your duty your prime duty is by the society not to serve government A, B, C or C not to serve minister A, B or C I told you right at the beginning engineer's job is to meet the needs of the society if you don't do that finally you will be responsible you can get out you'll not be caught but your conscience will always be pricking you if I had done that that bridge wouldn't have collapsed if I had not done that that building wouldn't have collapsed if I had not done that that circuit breaker wouldn't have been closed if I had not done that there wouldn't have been a power cut for 8 hours right I'm sure a lot of people's conscience may be pricking now and all these problems people's conscience are pricking even that innocent family in Kandy whoever did that I don't know they will escape they might escape they might show all the proofs but eternally they will be suffering their conscience will be pricking if I had done that if I had done that if I had done that they people will believe it. Three innocent people right if technologists and technicians try to do the job of engineers this is what's going to happen so try to find the role that the engineer has to play I told you engineers are supposed to be problem solvers engineers are supposed to be solving the complex the most complex problems don't allow anyone else to solve them once you solve them don't go and do their job we are very happy to do the technologist job and the technician job let them do that because they are skillful they have been trained to do that right but you do your job as engineers then this country will be a better place but are we prepared to face the challenge you said yes can we confidently say that we engineers in Sri Lanka will not let this happen can ISL assure that the chartered engineers you are going to be a chartered engineer are in a position to avoid this kind of disasters So once you get the charter you are about to sign, you are in a position to sign many documents. There are legal validity, there are the responsibility, Accountability. Everything is there in your signature. The answer is in your hands. No one can come and shoulder the responsibility. I will skip this. These are other things, right? I hate when people give me acronyms. Right? I just showed it to you, but you know, other times I ask you to, I show the first part and I ask you to give the full name. Many people fail. In this class, many people fail. So, one or two people who can always answer this question. And we are very good in talking in terms of acronyms. And when you are writing answers, never use acronyms. These three-letter words, four-letter words. If you do not know, use it, don't use it, number one. If you know, define and use it. First time you come across, you write that and say, this is what I'm going to use after that. Even the Ceylon Electric Board. I always say Ceylon Electric Board and put it because I put CB, and from that point onwards, I go on talking of CB. Who knows? A foreigner may be reading that. Who knows what CB is? Right? And it might go to a court of law. And if you have said CB, CB always, and the other lawyer can argue, that is Ceylon something, something, something. Right? Or Ceylon, say, Ceylon Engineers Board or something, they can say that. Do you know that I want a case? I want a case like that? Because the case was put against Lanka Electricity Board. Believe me, I won the case. I only went and told the courts, this is not for me. I don't belong to a Lanka Electric Company, Electricity Company Board. Lanka Vidur Mandale. Somebody translated the lawyer translated to Lanka Electricity Board. I tell you gospel truth. I don't tell lies to my wife. I don't tell lies to your students, right? Candidates, when they come, I don't tell lies. Lanka Electricity Board, I won the case. I'm doing apakot pale. The case was in early courts. Right? So these are very bad figures. The bottom line, 56%, 60%, sometimes 48%. Now it's increasing, 59%, 61%. Last exam was 80%. I was thrilled, very happy. Keep it up. Don't allow that to go down from this point onwards. Work hard and get yourself passed. How many of exam have you faced? But unfortunately, these things happen. Can you assure us that this will not happen this time? Write the correct question number, because when they packet them, they put all the questions in one, say question 1, 2 separately. But they are going to different examiners. There is one person who has not written the question number, and I had to read the whole answer and find out to which question he has answered. What a problem for us. Now we don't do that, right? We just throw it away. Proper handwriting. I know it's difficult, but I will tell you how to do it next time. How to write proper handwriting. Sometimes very difficult to read. There were instances when the examiner has given 0 marks since they could not read the writing. We get appeals. When you look at it, we can't do anything about it. Read the instructions clearly before start writing. Some answer 5 questions. Some answer both questions in section 1. So I will not go through this. I'll go to the final slide. They're already 7. So this is the schedule for you. Today is my lecture. You had Russell De Silva, Nihal Somavir on infrastructure that you had yesterday, right? Tomorrow, Sustained Development and Climate Change. Professor W. Sumathipala, Engine Society, Garmin Nanda Gunawadana, Infrastructure Power Bandhu Utilization, one of my colleagues, the tough guy, yeah? Infrastructure, Water, Bhadra Kamata. I don't know, other things, they have not been able to fix the lectures. On the 4th, you are going to have an exam. So, all the best for you. I am very sorry that Siddharth P.J. Vaidyasekhar is a good friend of mine. He does very well. But that's not being held. Are you ready?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes.
All the best for you. Right? So accept challenge. Do well. We hope to see you as a full-fledged chartered engineer very soon. All the best for you.